I want to thank everyone for being here today for our what was to be our last Whom You Love lecture. I just want to remind you that Mike Bailey will get rescheduled sometime early next year. I don't know how to tell you exactly to know, but we haven't set scheduled it yet. But if you're a Facebook friend or if you keep track on whomyoulove.com, you should know about it as we get near. So I want to give you some idea what I'm going to talk about today. So I'm going to first to tell you my personal story about how my ideas about this topic, whether or not biological forces influence sexual orientation, have changed over the last 15 years or so. And I also want to summarize what we've seen so far, and those two will kind of merge together. And after doing that, I'm going to give you a little bit of data that my group gathered that we haven't really talked about in detail, just to sort of fill in that picture. And then finally, I want to talk about some connections that have sort of come to my mind, at least in the course of these lectures, that might not have occurred to you. I don't know that the connections are valid, that they're true, but they're things that I'm thinking. And then, of course, I'll close with some caveats to make sure I'm not misunderstood, because this is kind of a tricky topic. So the question of the whole lecture series has been, does nature have a say in whom you love? Does nature have an influence on sexual orientation? And this is really a part of a bigger question. So one way to talk about sexual orientation, and I think it's rather strange to think that you can choose someone like Brad Pitt, let's say, and half of the planet would see him as an absolute ideal mating partner, and the other half of the planet would find him completely unacceptable. I mean, just completely rejected. And there is something, that's a very profound difference. And so most people are attracted to the opposite sex. And why most men are attracted to women and most women are attracted to men, that's part of a bigger question, which is why do the sexes behave differently at all? And that's a question that I spent most of my adult life asking in animal models. Why do the two sexes behave differently? And to some extent then, the question of sexual orientation is just a subset of that big question. And some sex differences in behavior are pretty easy to explain, right? Males in general tend to be larger, tend to be stronger than females, and so there's certain tasks where it just makes more sense for males to do more of the heavy lifting. And so that's what you see. But if you put aside those sorts of trivial sort of sex differences in behavior, then in the scientific field, the question that people have been asking is, why do males and females behave differently? And over 50 years ago now, there was some researchers, Spinney, Goy, Giral, and Young, who said, if we want to understand why male and female animals behave differently, we need to take as our cue what people are finding out about why the bodies of males and females develop differently. That if we can, and what was being found out at that time was that in general, for mammals, there's a pretty easy rule to understand whether you'll look like a male or look like a female. Those individuals who are exposed to testosterone early in life will look like males, have a male phenotype, and if they're not exposed to testosterone early in life, they'll look like females. And so what people were finding was that early in life, we all look alike. Everyone looks the same. Everyone has what are known as the indifferent gonads. They don't quite look like ovaries and don't quite look like testes. But by 8 weeks of age, in some individuals, the gonads start looking more like testes. And these testes are secreting hormone that is then masculinizing the outside of the individual. Other individuals, the indifferent gonads develop more like ovaries. And in that case, they're not secreting much hormone at that point in life. And in the absence of those hormones, the outside sort of looks like that of a female. And this was a very powerful and simple explanation for why male and female phenotypes would be different in animals. And Phoenix, Goy, Giral, and Young said, maybe the same is true for the brain. So they proposed the organizational hypothesis that if the brain was exposed to testosterone early in life, which is normally the case in males, it would be organized in a male fashion. And if it wasn't exposed to testosterone early in life, which is the normal case for females, then it would be organized in a female fashion. So in other words, what the biologists have been finding out was that if you have a Y chromosome, you'll make testes. The testes make testosterone and some other hormones, but we'll talk mostly about testosterone. And the testosterone then forms the outside to look like a male. In the absence of a Y chromosome, then an ovary develops, and the ovaries aren't secreting much testosterone, and the testosterone, in the absence of testosterone, then a female phenotype will appear, clitoris, labia, and vagina, rather than penis, scrotum, et cetera. Well, what Fainscrow and Giral and Young were suggesting is that the brain is just one more target that's listening to the same signal, the same unifying signal. Are we male or are we female? And that if the brain was exposed to testosterone early in life, it would be organized in a male fashion. And for the rest of that individual's life would behave in a male-like fashion, you know, pursuing male-like goals. And in the absence of testosterone, then the brain would be organized in a female fashion. And in that case, for the rest of the animal's life, they would be seeking more feminine goals. And for a wide range of behaviors in a vast number of animals that have been looked at, that has been the case. That simple rule has explained almost every sex difference in behavior we've been able to find in animals. And not only that, it turns out that there are parts of the brain that are different in males and females. I've spent a lot of my life looking in the spinal cord, looking at a place where that males have a lot more neurons than females do. People in the lab are looking at other areas. I won't talk about their names, et cetera. I love them all. They're all fascinating. And actually, in graduate school, I found out that there was a sex difference here between males and females. And I thought, and it turns out, what the thing that they all have in common is you can take a female and you can make her as masculine as you like just by controlling how much testosterone she gets. So if you give her enough testosterone and give it early, she'll be as masculine as any male. And as a graduate student, I thought, well, that's great. I know testosterone makes this difference arise. All I have to do is find out where the testosterone does and what it does, and I'll understand how it works. And, you know, 30-some years later, I'm almost there. I think we've learned a lot, but it's been interesting that we don't know it all. Well, the point is, this sort of research is what I've sort of devoted my life to, and all the time I was doing it, I really didn't think that it had much to do with humans. Fainscrow, Giral, and Young, yeah, that explains sex differences in animal behavior, but really, is prenatal testosterone having a direct organizing influence on the human brain? And I started out as a scientist quite skeptical of that notion for several reasons. You might ask, well, why would you even ask? Why would you expect humans to be the exception? Well, there's an excellent reason why. There's a terrific alternative explanation for humans, right? Given that we are so, we're born at such an undeveloped state, we take such a long time to grow up, we are so sensitive to social influences, it's entirely possible, I thought it was entirely possible that sex differences in behavior could be a result of social experience. That is, that boys and girls come into the world a tabula rasa, as Locke would have said, they're completely open to be either one thing or the other, and they're taught how to behave. And why do most of them are attracted to the opposite sex? Because from the very earliest stages, they are inculcated into that way of thinking. And so, of course, what else would they think? The alternative hypothesis, right, is that maybe humans are like animals in this regard. Maybe prenatal androgens masculinize the nervous system. And if we were to apply this to sexual orientation, we can think of a relatively simple hypothesis to explain why most males are attracted to women and most women are attracted to men. We can talk about whether they are androphilic, meaning they're attracted to males, or gynophilic, that they're attracted to females. And so you can imagine that if we were to look at a distribution of the number of individuals who are getting various exposure to testosterone, that those that are getting exposed to a lot of testosterone before birth will be gynophilic, as most males are, and those that aren't being exposed to much testosterone before birth will be androphilic, as most females are. And that then there might be some threshold amount, in the simplest minded fashion, there might be some threshold amount in which people would be either gynophilic or androphilic. And certainly I can tell you, it's not as easy. If we look at other behaviors in animals, this sort of simple rule is not bad, right? It explains a lot of the variance. So that's one possibility. If you're So I want to point out that my interest is why do people have a sexual orientation at all? And if they do have a sexual orientation, why do they have the one they have? Now this, you might think that I'm obsessed with homosexuality because I talk about that a lot. But it's really, that's not what's going on. I need to point out to you that to distinguish between these two hypotheses, those of you who are straight are completely useless to me. You have no value because you are equally explained by either hypothesis. On the other hand, people who are homosexual, they contradict both hypotheses, right? They're both ignoring what the prenatal androgen told them to do, and they're ignoring what society told them to do. And you know, in the face of a lot of resistance, they still have these feelings, right? And so that requires explanation. And I'm just pointing out that if we can understand why some people are attracted to the same sex, the value of that, for me at least, isn't to try to explain their sexual orientation away or to fix their sexual orientation, doesn't need fixing. It is to try to understand the bigger picture. Why does anyone have any sexual orientation? So there. So I was a complete skeptic about the biological hypothesis for most of my life. So why? A couple of reasons. First of all my degrees are in psychology, right? And so I'm used to thinking about how sensitive we are to the environment, how good we are at learning, how dependent we are on language and things like that. And I can tell you, I can remember my freshman year in college, I took a course in introductory psychology. It was taught by the truly eminent developmental psychologist, William Kesson. This was at Yale. And I remember him telling me about the John Joan case that Alice told you about these twin boys who, because of an accident at a circumcision, one loses his penis, and eventually the decision is made to surgically make him look like a girl and raise him as a girl. And what I was told in 1973 was that this little girl was perfectly happy being a little girl, wearing a dress, was treated as a girl by her family, and had adjusted to take on the female sex role. And nobody talked about who she was attracted to, but I certainly got the message that she, of course, was going to marry some man someday and everything would be fine. Well, it turned out, I'm not blaming William Kesson for this, it turned out that that was not actually the case. It would be many years later before people would learn that, in fact, Brenda had hated being treated as a girl, had rebelled against being a girl for a long time, and eventually refused treatment and began living as a man. So you can read about this in the fascinating book, As Nature Made Him, by John Colapinto. And here's a picture. He eventually took the name David. He chose a new name, and chose a nice biblical masculine name, David. And clearly was happy as a man, would eventually marry a woman with children and would adopt them. And he reported that even as a child, he fantasized about someday growing up and having a sports car and a girlfriend. Right? So in fact, his orientation was quite masculine. And his story is also a very sad one. He would eventually kill himself. Well, when this story came out, when the truth came out, that in fact he wasn't happily as a woman, a lot of people, I think, overinterpreted that. And one of our other speakers made the same point. It's not this, if you wanted this to tell you, why was it important for him to be David? Was it because his brain was exposed to testosterone before birth and that caused him to want to take on this role? Well, that's a possibility, but on the other hand, it's really a lousy case. Because first of all, the circumcision was done at 7 months of age, so the family had already been used to having a boy for a while. It would be a while yet before he'd be reassigned as a girl. It seems pretty clear the parents, you know, were having a hard time treating this child as a girl. And I mean, it's just, in the end, it was just one case. So even when it was found out that he was not happy as a girl, I didn't find that very convincing, that sexual orientation, for example, is mostly a matter of biology. The others, piece of evidence that many people found persuasive, that prenatal testosterone makes you more likely to be attracted to women, involved the cases of congenital adrenal hyperplasia that Alice spoke about a little bit. This is a syndrome in which, because there's a gene missing, so that the individual, or that's not functioning, so the individual cannot make glucocorticoid hormones from the adrenal glands, these individuals have an interesting prenatal exposure. So the problem is they are not able to make the glucocorticoids, which normally would tell the brain you don't need to release more ACTH. But in these individuals, because the glucocorticoid is missing, this negative feedback is missing, the brain puts out lots of ACTH. It's really driving, where's those glucocorticoids I'm calling for? And eventually the adrenal glands swell up, which is why it's called hyperplasia. And as a result of that, they are making some hormones that include androgens, and the androgens then can masculinize genitalia. And so when these individuals, when these children are born, when this happens in an XX individual, when these children are born, they have ambiguous genitalia. And so here's some examples of what these children can look like. And so they are, you know, tend to be somewhere in between normal males and normal females. And Alice told you some about how those individuals are treated, at least in this society. And for many people, girls with CAH, they found that a persuasive argument that prenatal testosterone determines sexual orientation, because because those girls are more likely to be lesbians when they grow up. But and it's important, most of them grow up to be straight, but they are more likely than the general population to be lesbians when they grow up. Well, for someone that's a real skeptic, these are like beautifully ambiguous results. These are the sorts of things you cannot make any firm conclusion. You know, it's half full or it's half empty. I mean, really, if testosterone was having a big influence on sexual orientation, why wouldn't they all be lesbians, right? And on the other hand, so I didn't find that very persuasive. And I won't go through it all, but it didn't take me very long to think of ways in which the CAH condition might make the girls slightly more likely to be attracted to women when they grow up through social factors. So, for example, what are the parents thinking when the baby comes out looking, in some cases, like a boy? What's going on in their minds? If the genitalia are left intact, which is more often the case these days, but didn't apply to earlier cohorts, well, what does a child think when they see their genitalia compared to others? Or if the surgery is done to make the genitalia look more like females, what does that do to the child's thinking to have doctors and, you know, interested in their genitalia and doing these surgeries? And then how does that enter into her psyche? And then if her genitalia don't quite look like other genitalia, either because it's been corrected or because it's been corrected and the correction is, you know, probably in some cases is not perfect, what's the girl's attitude about her own genitalia, and how does she feel about being intimate with someone when there's been all this attention to her genitalia? I mean, it was easy for me to think of ways in which the prenatal testosterone that she was exposed made her more likely to be lesbian, even though it didn't do anything to her brain. That what happened was she was more likely to be lesbian because of what the testosterone did to her body and because of the social reactions of other people. Another thing that for some people was persuasive that biological factors influence sexual orientation was Simon LaVey's report that he told you about, of a part of the brain called INA3 in humans that is larger in males than in females, here are the individual values, and is smaller in volume in gay males than in straight males. And in fact, in his sample, in gay males, the nucleus was about the same size as in normal females. So for many people, this was very persuasive that sexual orientation is a biological event or a biological characteristic. But again, you know, this is the burden of being a really strong skeptic. But for me, I did not find that very persuasive. For me, what these findings pointed out to us, is that sexual orientation is not just skin deep, right? It's not, I mean, clearly there's something different about these individuals if you can find a difference in their brain. So it's not some superficial veneer. On the other hand, the only way you can look at INA3 is in an adult postmortem. There's no way to look at it more than once in a given individual because it's just too small. Non-invasive imaging systems just won't work. And so we don't know whether these men were homosexual because they were born with a smaller INA3, or did they develop a smaller INA3 because some other factors caused them to be homosexuals. You see? And I should point out to you, remember when I told you, when I introduced Simon, the first week in graduate school, I saw a stunning photomicrograph that he had created that talked about the wiring system between the eye and the brain. And one of the things Simon was famous for before he did this was showing that visual experience could affect the structure of the brain, could affect the wiring of the brain. And so especially if you know that, then you look at this and you say, well, this certainly convinces me that sexual orientation is not just, certainly not an affectation. It's not just some superficial difference. But it doesn't really tell me how the sexual orientation came about. So you're all on my side now? You're all good skeptics like me? This, what biology? You know, and that was just where I stood. And so I can tell you when I first saw any evidence that I could not explain away through social influences. And that was Dennis McFadden's work looking at otoacoustic emissions, where I'll remind you, you're all making sounds in your ear right now that you can't hear, you're not attending to, but Dennis can put you in a quiet room and put a microphone in your ear, and he'll hear these sounds coming from your ears. And these are not an accident, they're not a bad thing, they are good, they help you to fine-tune your hearing so that you can zero in on and listen to particular whatever it is you're interested in, right? It's a very important aspect of hearing physiology. And women make more of these sounds than men do, which is one of the reasons why women have better hearing than men have. And, you know, the joke I always point out, I didn't say anything about listening. I have no idea why there's a sex difference in listening, but there's also a sex difference in hearing, and this is one of the things that contributes to that. And that sex difference is present at birth, right? So it's not a result of, you know, of one sex being exposed to different sounds than the other. There's pretty good evidence that it reflects prenatal testosterone. So when in 1998, when Dennis McFadden made this report, he said, here's the sex difference. Here, straight men, the number of spontaneous otoacoustic emissions in straight men versus women, and there's the sex difference that we know is present at birth. And what he found was that women who said that they were gay had fewer of these than women that were straight, and women that reported being bi were somewhere in between. And here then, I mean, I didn't know how to explain this as being socially mediated. How would that work? And it's interesting how people are different. You know, I think a lot of people dismiss this finding because it's so weird, right? Otoacoustic emission. They never heard of them. I don't see them. You know, how important can they be? You know, and of course, no one thinks that these individuals are gay because they're making fewer otoacoustic emissions, right? That's not what's going on. And so for many people, it was just like, you know, well, shrug it off. But for someone who's been, you know, really questioning this idea about whether biological or social influences, here I have a problem. I don't know how to explain this as it being socially mediated. And what's important is you have to understand what made it persuasive to me was because it was cryptic, because nobody knew about it, right? I couldn't imagine any little girls out there thinking, well, I'm not making very many sounds in my ears. Maybe, you know, what am I supposed to do here? What sort of sex role am I supposed to take on? And it's not like the parents or the teachers said, you know, well, you're not making very many sounds. Maybe you should go roughhouse with the other boys. The fact that it was, you know, that it was latent and unknown meant that I don't see how it could have been socially mediated. And so that's where I am in 1998. I was really quite taken with this finding. And so in 1999, I'm sitting in my office, this is why I was still at Berkeley, and I'm reading a paper that refers to a paper that came out the year before that talked about a sex difference in the human body that I had never heard of. I mean, here I've been studying sex differences in animals all my adult life, and I'd never heard of this. And the paper said that this was a sex difference that was present in two-year-old children. And as soon as I heard that it was in two-year-old children, before puberty, I mean, I knew enough about the sexual differentiation literature to know that in all probability, this sex difference in finger lengths, I'm going to show you what they are in a moment, is probably resulting from prenatal testosterone. So what's the sex difference? So it's sometimes known as a 2D-4D ratio. So the 2D being your index finger and 4D being your ring finger. So here's how you can measure 2D-4D ratios. You can just make a Xerox copy of people's hands, and you measure. If they're in their index finger, in this case, is about 78 millimeters, and the ring finger, 4D, is about 83 millimeters, you divide the two, and you get a ratio that's less than one, right? And that's a typical male result. On the other hand, in women, there are times at least when you can see women who have an index finger that's a little bit longer than a ring finger. And so when you do that ratio, it may be a little bit more than one. Now, I see several of you looking at your hands. I want to reach out to you and let you know you're going to be okay. I'm going to walk you through this, and you don't have to panic. So this sex difference is there, but I need you to know that it's subtle. So if you're a female and you looked at your hand and your index finger is a little shorter than your ring finger, it's okay. You're going to be all right. Because this sex difference is fairly subtle. You can find lots of men who have a bigger sex digit ratio than the average woman, and lots of women who have a digit ratio that's smaller than the average man. There's a lot of overlap. So for the psychologists, we talk about sex differences in terms of a D prime. How many standard deviations are there between the mean of one population versus the other? And this graph I happen to find has a D prime of about 0.4, and that's about the overlap between men and women in digit ratio, right, in 2D, 4D, right? So it's easy to find lots of men who have a digit ratio that's higher than some women. Or to go back to the previous slide, in fact, when we measure the sex difference, it's a little bigger than that. It's 0.5, okay, half a standard deviation different. And Cohen, in his book, he called that a medium-sized effect. And in psychology, we'd consider that a medium-sized effect because, of course, we so often have to do statistics and have to work so hard to find differences at all because humans are such horrible research subjects. They're all so different from one another. We're struggling with that all the time. And he gives a great example. A D prime of 0.5 is about the difference in height between 14-year-old girls and 18-year-old girls on average. And you know there are lots of 14-year-old girls who are taller than the average 18-year-old girl, and there's lots of overlap between the two. So for example, if I were to say, here's 20 girls over here, and 10 of them are 14 and 10 of them are 18, and you tried to classify them based on height, you'd be wrong a lot, right? On the other hand, if I say, here's two groups of girls, right, and one group is a 14-year-old and the other is 18-year-old, and I'm not going to tell you which is which, but you can look at their heights and guess, right? Well, if I really had a random sample of 14 and 18-year-old girls there, I can assure you, if 10 in each group, you'll know which is which, right? You'll have absolutely no problem knowing which is which, right? Those must be the 18-year-olds, and those must be the 14-year-olds. Does everyone have the idea? So, or to give you another example of this, it would later turn out that the sex difference in digit ratios in people isn't just present in two-year-olds, it's present before birth. So here's some data from another paper, I didn't do this work, where the girls are shown as triangles and the boys as circles. They're looking at the left hand and the right hand, and down here they're looking at age, and up here they have, that line represents the average for females, and this dotted line represents the average for males. So they're different from one another. If we use statistics, we can see the difference, and they're fairly stable, left hand and right hand. But you couldn't classify these individuals as male or female based on digit ratios and be right very often. So on the one hand, by the way, if it's present in before birth, then we know it's not socially mediated, right? It can't be, right? Because these individuals haven't had a chance to have people treat them differently yet based on whether they're male or female. On the other hand, you can see that if it's telling you how much prenatal testosterone they were exposed to, it's not a very good marker. It's very imperfect. Okay. So is it responding to prenatal testosterone? I could give another whole lecture to talk about this, but just take my word for it. There's absolutely no doubt now that this sex difference in digit ratios is due to the sex difference in prenatal testosterone. So here's the one study that we did to address this. Given what I've told you so far, if indeed it was listening to prenatal testosterone, then you have a prediction about what you'd see in women who have CAH, right? We know that they saw more testosterone than control women. At birth, they're identified and given medicines that will stop making more testosterone. So they should be a great test case. And indeed, if you look in such individuals, in the right hand, the individuals who have CAH, those girls, those women, have more masculine digit ratios than women who did not have CAH. And so that's exactly what you'd expect. I want to point out a couple of things. First of all, and so we reported this in 2002, and there was a group in Europe reported it the very next month. And so it's been replicated. I want to point out to you that we usually see differences in the right hand more than the left. So it looks like the right hand is more sensitive to prenatal testosterone than the left hand. I don't know why. Does that have something to do with being left-handed? No. And so so I can't explain why, but for some reason the right hand is a better read of prenatal testosterone, though far from perfect. So what's great about digit ratios? There's several things that are great about digit ratios. Again, I can assure you, in 1999, nobody knew about this. Nobody was looking at their hands and thinking, uh-oh, that doesn't look right, right? No parents were thinking that, no teachers. So again, it was a cryptic indicator, prenatal testosterone. That means that it's difficult to think how it could be socially mediated. I also love the fact that you can measure the Xerox machine, right? So this was I'd worked with animals all my life. This was the first time I'd actually done an experiment with human beings. It was the cheapest experiment I've ever done. I mean, it was unbelievable. I was agog. Science is so inexpensive when you don't work with animal subjects. So all we needed was like a $400 Xerox machine. They were expensive back then, and a ruler to measure the Xeroxes. And that came, that set us back another 99 cents. And so it was like, and how did we get people to tell us? So we decided. I expired by Dennis McFadden's results. That we've got to see whether there's a difference in sexual orientation and digit ratios. And how are we going to get people to tell us and let us do this? It's fine. We found that we had a great incentive, and it turned out this also made an incredibly cheap experiment. We asked people very detailed questions about who do you have sex with, what sex do you have sex with, what sex do you fantasize about having sex with, and then tell us more, how do you consider yourself? We asked them a lot of other questions. We also asked them whether right or left-handed, but that was just kind of a lure. But because then we said, can we Xerox your hands? And so people were happy to do that if we offered them a $1 lottery scratcher ticket. The subject was so cheap. So we went to street fairs, 2-day street fairs, but we never had any tickets left for the second day because people will tell you anything for a $1 lottery scratcher ticket, which is especially weird because if you do the math, it's worth like 18 cents, right? But people were excited about it anyway. So we go out in the Bay Area and we go to gay street fairs and regular street fairs, and we ask people these invasive questions, and they're happy to answer. And what we found, I'm going to ignore the left hand for a moment. For the right hand, we saw a sex difference. That is, we saw the digit ratio was greater in women than in men. We actually didn't see a sex difference in the left hand. Sometimes we don't. And what we did see, though, was that women who said they were lesbians had a more masculine digit ratio than women who said that they were straight. And I'll point out to you, I'll talk about it some more. We saw absolutely no difference between homosexual males and heterosexual males, either in the left hand or the right hand, which was interesting. And it could have been, I mean, I didn't have any preconceptions about this, but we didn't see that. But we did see this difference between lesbians and straight women. And the next year, we went back to another street fair, just a gay street fair just in the East Bay that has lots of lesbians. It's a great place to find those subjects. And we asked one more question we didn't ask before. Do you consider yourself butch or femme? And we didn't define it. We didn't, you know, and we had, you know, over 170 women who both identified as lesbians and were willing to circle one box or the other. And what we found was that it was the women who described themselves as butch who had more masculine digit ratios than the women who described themselves as femme. And I point this out because you remember from Meredith Chivers' talk that women, for whatever reason, seem to be more fluid in their terms of their sexual orientation. There are some women who are straight in one time in their life and are, you know, and eventually fall in love with another woman. And so we know that that sort of fluidity is there. And so no one's trying to say that all cases of lesbianism are due to prenatal testosterone, right? I don't know that. I'm sure there are some cases that are not. I can't tell you which are and which aren't, but the point is that, I mean, you do wonder whether these women are the ones that are lesbian because they got exposed to more prenatal testosterone, and these women came to homosexuality through another route, right? So this got a lot of attention from a lot of people. I will never ever do a study again that will have so many people replicate it or even try to. No one will be interested in any other, all those things I do with rats and mice and hamsters, nobody's gonna bother to replicate those, right? I mean, it happens, but no one really cares. So we published that in 2000, and for a while, every calendar year, there was at least one paper published that would replicate that. And at this point, if you want to do a study and have absolutely no editor publish it, replicate our study, because there's absolutely no call to publish this anymore. There was at least one failure to replicate, but you put it all together. Some people did a meta-analysis not long ago, and it turns out that you'd have to have 58 null findings in a row to question whether there's a difference between lesbians and straight women in this. Okay, so that's... I should point out, the other reason there's so many replications, of course, is because it's so easy to do, right? You don't need a cyclotron, you only need a Xerox machine and a ruler, right? And people, you know, that'll tell you their sexual orientation. I also want to point out that of the replications, this is in some ways the most impressive to me, even though it has the smallest sample size. Hall and Love got 7 pairs of monozygotic twins, girls, women, in which one was gay and the other was straight. And with that tiny sample size, they saw a significant difference. That is, the lesbian twin would have a more masculine digit ratio than the straight twin. So I don't know how to explain this difference between lesbians and straight women. I don't know how to explain that except to say that if you're exposed to a little more prenatal testosterone as a girl, you are more likely to develop a lesbian orientation. I don't see any way that there can be a social mediation of this, right? I mean, it seems to me kind of inescapable. Plus, it really fits with other things. It fits with the otoacoustic emissions that Dennis also saw a difference in otoacoustic emissions between homosexual and heterosexual women, but saw no difference between heterosexual and homosexual men. And that's what we saw for otoacoustic emission, for digit ratios. And then there are some other things. There are these sex differences in the ratios of the long bones of the body that show the same sort of pattern. And of course, it fits with the idea that women with CAH would be more likely to be lesbians when they grow up. And of course, it fits with a wide range of heritability studies that Mike Bailey will tell us about someday. So this finding, I'm obviously very proud of it. I'm quite confident that we were right. And I think it means something. I think it means that, you know, that prenatal testosterone does matter, at least for women. And I got a lot of guff for it, and I think mostly for people that misunderstood. So there were two different women, journalists, who published pieces that were critical. And I should say that I had lots of strangers contact me by email and phone and letter afterwards, and many of them were quite hostile, and all the ones who were hostile were very homophobic. I know you're gay and you're lying to justify your lifestyle and, you know, et cetera, et cetera. And I had several, lots of advice about how to take care of my afterlife. Everyone who contacted me who identified themselves as homosexual were very positive, and were and of course, and there were lots of parents who parents of gay people who were felt very positively about it. But there were two journalists who self-identified as lesbians who were really angry that we even asked this question. So here's an example from Salon where this woman said, you know, that it was mean-spirited science. You know, it was mean to even ask the question. She uses this phrase mean-spirited twice. And she says, she reads the headline, she looks at her hand and sees that she hasn't been living a lie. I guess that means her index finger was shorter than her ring finger. And then she's angry though, because she's wondering, she's tempted to go look at her daughter's hand, right? Like a preview or something. And I could have saved her the trouble. So here's a misunderstanding that I want to clear up with you right now. So if you like, I will teach you now how to take a random sample of people and look at their hand and look at the digit ratio and guess their sexual orientation, and you're going to be right about 95% of the time. Would you like me to teach you how to do that? Okay, so I insist you got to look at your right hand. So you get your random sample of people, you bring each one of them together, you look carefully at the right hand, you notice whether the index finger is shorter than the ring finger, and then no matter what, you see, guess straight. And you'll be right 95% of the time if it was a random sample. So that's the secret. So in other words, you can't use this. 2D4D is not good for telling you anything about an individual, right? Just as you can't tell whether someone's male or female from the digit ratio, you certainly can't tell whether they're gay or straight. So it can't be used to that without lots of errors. And so it won't reveal to you someone's secret characteristic. And by the way, you know, why would you want to know? I mean, why would you want... It kind of hurt my feelings that people misunderstood this. It's like, we don't need a way to tell whether someone's gay or straight. We already know how to do that. That technology is pretty low tech. What is that? How do we know if someone's gay or straight? You ask them. Right. So, you know, you don't even need a Xerox machine for that. It'd save even more money. In other words, it's not a shibboleth. And I won't give a Bible school lesson here, but a shibboleth is some secret sign to let you know whether somebody is A or B, right? And it's not a shibboleth. It doesn't work for that. But I do want to talk about, what about sexual orientation in men? Does prenatal testosterone make any difference in men? I don't think so. We didn't see it. We saw no evidence of a difference between heterosexual and homosexual males. Dennis McFadden didn't see it. I don't think there's much reason to think that the variance in sexual orientation in males has anything to do with variance in prenatal testosterone. And if we look at the animal literature, I think we can understand why that might be so. So we know, for example, this is way long ago, back in 1952, before we could measure hormones. William Young and associates, they noticed that among guinea pigs, some male guinea pigs copulate a lot more than others. They're a lot more vigorous than others. And they came up with ways of measuring this. And so they could take a bunch of guinea pigs and they could classify them as in the high drive, medium drive, or low drive. And they took these males and studied their behavior, and then they castrated them, and they knew that when the testosterone went away entirely, they'd all stop copulating. But now they give them either a low dose of testosterone or a high dose, and they're all getting exactly the same amount of testosterone, and yet they segregate again by type. That is, those that didn't show much drive before don't show much now, and those that showed more drive before do show more now, and it's not because of how much testosterone they get. And doubling the testosterone won't make these low drive individuals much different. So, what we know in this sort of case is that androgen has a permissive effect. If they have no testosterone around whatsoever, they will not copulate, those males. But as long as there's just a little bit around, they'll copulate. And whether there's differences between them isn't due to differences in how much testosterone they have. Rather, the differences between them are due to how they are responding to the testosterone that they have. And so, one possibility, I don't think there's any reason to think that gay males and straight males differ in how much prenatal testosterone they're exposed to. As Dennis McFadden pointed out, for one thing, gay men on average have larger genitalia than straight men. Well, how would that jibe with having less prenatal testosterone. That's really not, there's no way to explain that. So what I'm proposing is that the difference between gay and straight men, that they all get all the testosterone they need to get the maximum gynophilic effect, but that for some reason, some of them aren't responding to that. And to explain what might be going on there, I need to do a little bit of biology to tell you how hormones work. So steroid hormones, they're small molecules that pass easily into cells, and if the cell's a target cell, they bind to a steroid receptor, and then the steroid hormone and receptor together go into the nucleus, bind to DNA, and alter gene expression. So, for example, testosterone could act on the androgen receptor, and then it goes to the cells, and it regulates expression of particular genes that'll start process X, for example. And if life was simple, if organisms worked the way a human would engineer them, this would all be all there is to the story. But natural selection doesn't make things simple. In fact, the same testosterone and androgen receptor can work in very different tissues and cause very different things to happen, right? So the same hormone, testosterone, is going to the genitalia to do one set of things. It's going to muscles to have another effect. It's acting on the heart to have a different effect. It's acting on the brain to have yet other effects. And so I think what's going on is that it's not that gay men and straight men differ in how much T they get or what their androgen receptors are like. Rather, they're differing in how some genes respond. So, for example, let's talk about various sex differences in behavior. Again, we're using this D prime to let you know about sex differences where, you know, here are the sex differences in behavior that people spent some time talking about. That women are better at verbal skills than men. Men tend to do better on math skills than women, although that sex difference is disappearing. In Iceland right now, it's girls that on average score slightly better on math tests than boys do. That may very well have been a completely culturally derived difference. So these are all, you know, differences, and they're, you know, medium-sized differences, but the big differences, the big sex differences are not in those more cognitive things. They are in sexual attitudes. So the sex difference in interest in casual sex, males are much more interested than women. Whether they're attracted to older partners, women are attracted to older partners, men aren't. Concern for attractiveness, there's medium size. Frequency of masturbation is a big sex difference. Males are much more likely to masturbate than females. Interest in visual pornography, enormous sex difference. Women aren't particularly concerned about pictures of naked people, and guys are. So what's interesting about this cartoon from the New Yorker, imagine if the husband and wife, if their positions are switched here, you have no idea what the gag is. What would it be, right? I mean, and yet here, you know exactly what's going on. Well, my point is that for all of these differences, sex differences in behavior, gay men are just as masculine as straight men, right? In no way do they seem to be under-masculinized, which is what you'd think if it was a global, you know, a global difference in testosterone. So what I'm proposing is that I think that in gay men, I think the digits are responding fine to testosterone, the genitalia, the sex drive, but for some reason, the genes that are going to trigger gynophilia aren't responding. And by the way, those are probably the same genes that are responsible for, because those small differences I told you, those small sex differences, gay men tend to be somewhat feminine in those regards. But in terms of sex drive, they're just as masculine as other males. So what are these genes? The way I think of it is some of the variance in sexual orientation in women is due to variance upstream from the androgen receptor, variance in how much testosterone they get exposed to. But the variance in sexual orientation in men, I think, is due to things that are happening downstream of the androgen receptor, right? And specifically, that there are some genes that aren't responding to the androgen receptor in males. And of course, unfortunately, I have no idea what those genes are. I have some predictions, right? I predict that these are genes that are being driven by androgen, that they're being expressed in the brain, and that they're not the genes that androgen is driving to cause changes in genitalia and digit ratios and places like that. And so the gene that Simon LeVay told you about, that Dean Hamer found evidence for, there's some gene on the X chromosome that makes males more likely to be gay when they grow up. That could be a gene that, for whatever, that variant doesn't respond as well to androgen receptor. Or Ray Blanchard's older brother effect. The fact that for each additional older brother a boy has that his mother carried before him, his chance of being gay when he grows up increases by a third. But I'll remind you, that's only true if they're right-handed. For boys that are left-handed, they don't respond to the older brother effect. So that too suggests that there's something about the organization of the brain that makes one susceptible to the older brother effect or immune to it. And we don't know what that is, but we know, it seems likely, at least to me, that it could be in the brain. So I'll sum up in a moment. I just want to take another aside to talk about some connections that came to the fore in my thinking in the course of this symposium that might not have occurred to you. So one of them is, we've had lots of different speakers suggest to us that gender identity is a lot more malleable than sexual orientation. That how you behave as a male or a female, or whether you consider yourself to be a male or a female, is different than who are you sexually attracted to. That who you're sexually attracted to doesn't seem to be nearly as malleable as gender. So for example, we know that gender roles have changed dramatically across history, right, in terms of how one behaves, right? If we go way back in time, say like to the 1950s, you know, guys had to look very different than they do today, right? And behave differently. And then Paul Vasey, when he's talking about in Samoa, here's this third gender role that's available, right? You can be fafafine, right? And so those boys who, when they grow up, are going to be attracted to males, they can fit into that role. And in Samoa, they, in many ways, they present as women. They wear dresses. They like makeup. They wear their hair long, etc. Well, those same boys in the United States, those boys who, when they grow up, are going to be attracted to males, they don't have any trouble taking on the male gender identity here and acting like males here. The vast majority of them, even though they're showing behavior that is discordant somewhat for their gender, and we know that when they grow up, they're likely to be attracted to men, but in our society, they can take on that gender role. And then Eric Villain reported that in those cases of boys who are born with a cloacal extrophy, where there's no genitalia formed, they have testes, their brains have been exposed to testosterone before birth, but the surgeons have to close up the abdomen somehow, and it's a lot easier to make them look like girls than boys. Well, when they get to be 10, 12, 14, some of those boys, some of those girls, report that they really feel like they're boys, but many of them seem to be okay being, you know, girls. They seem to be okay with that. Now, the question will be, when they grow up, who are they going to be attracted to? Right? And we don't know yet, but my guess is, I wouldn't be surprised if they're all attracted to females, you know, whatever, you know, because of that prenatal testosterone. Time will tell. So that's one of the things I'm coming away with, is whether you can fit into one gender role or not is maybe more malleable. We are socially plastic individuals, after all, but in terms of who really makes you excited, who are you really attracted to, it's not so clear that you can change that, or certainly it's not so clear that males can change that readily. And that brings me to the next connection that came to my mind, is I think that there's an aversive component to sexual orientation, at least in men, right? So I'll go back to what I said at the beginning. How is it that half the world finds Brad Pitt an absolutely perfect mating partner, and the other half finds him unacceptable? I mean, he's not even vaguely acceptable. And notice that doesn't work if I say Angelina Jolie, right? So half might see her as an incredibly attractive mate, but the other half, the women, they don't see her as unacceptable. It's just, they can imagine having that as a mating. So I think there is this. I think for males in particular, and I think the prenatal testosterone might be behind this. I think for males, it's not just that they're attracted to females, but most males are really, you know, don't like the idea of having sex with another male. There's really a difference there. And it was Chuck Roselli describing his screening system that really brought this home for me. So let's talk about these male-oriented rams, right? So they will happily mount another ram, and they'll ejaculate, and they, you know, presumably they have an orgasm, right? Natural selection's way of saying you just did the right thing, right? So they like that. But in those tests, those males, and this was 8% of the males, they're given a total of 18 hours in the presence of at least one ewe that has been made sexually receptive, and they never mount her once. I mean, don't they like having an orgasm? It does sort of like there's an aversive component there. I mean, I don't know how to explain that except to say they really don't like that idea. And I do wonder whether that's one of the things that's going on in humans. And then, and in humans, right, if you ask people if they have homosexual fantasies, women are more likely to say, straight women, people who, women who describe themselves as straight, are more likely to say that they've had those fantasies than men. And I don't think it's just a difference in reluctance to talk about it. I think that might be a genuine difference. And both Sari Van Anders and Meredith Chivers talked to us about this. This could also be why there's more fluidity in sexual orientation in females than in males. And I do wonder whether this echoes evolutionary pressures, because, you know, in most mammals, keep in mind that in most mammalian species, most males who reach reproductive age never get to copulate even once, right? Not even once, right? And virtually every female who reaches reproductive age will find someone that will donate some sperm to her, right? That's not a problem in general. And so there's lots of male-male competition, and that's just how it is in mammals. And in females, in many mammalian species, females can cooperate and, you know, help each other out, and there's no cost to them, right? It doesn't cost them in terms of next generation contributing to the next generation. So to sum up what I think the series has talked to us about, Francis Bacon really got started the scientific method by saying that if you want to understand what's really going on, you look for you look for lots of signs that all point in the same direction, right? The instances of the finger post, as he called them, you know, these signs, these quaint signs that they have in England in that day. And so if we look at that, where do they point? So girls with CAH are more likely to be lesbian than controls. Otoacoustic emission suggests lesbians, on average, we're seeing more prenatal testosterone. So the digit ratios, so the skeletal ratios. I didn't talk about these other factors, but they too suggest that women who are lesbians are exposed to slightly more testosterone before birth. And so I don't know how to explain that except to say that girls exposed to more androgen before birth are more likely to be gay when they grow up. Certain to be gay? No, but more likely. And how about for males? Well, for males, we haven't talked about it yet. Mike Bailey will get here. It's clear there's a heritability component. It's clear that genes matter. There's also that sexual antagonism effect that Paul Vasey and Ray Blanchard talked about. That is, that gay males, their female relatives tend to have more children than the female relatives of straight males, right? That suggests that. And then there's the older brother effect itself. The fact that boys who early on are showing gender nonconformity, the fact that most of them, when they grow up, are going to be gay, that suggests that something was going on early, right, in those individuals, and also that it was something that was resisting social pressure. The fact that gay males are more likely to be left-handed, and the fact that the animal model suggests that hormones play a role in sexual orientation, all those indicate that there are prenatal processes that affect the likelihood that a boy will grow up to be gay. And I think what's interesting, and this is why we do science, is to, you know, find which hypotheses to keep and which ones to get rid of. But I think it's interesting that prenatal androgen is probably not responsible for it. So having said all that about that, I think the finger posts make it clear that there are prenatal influences on human sexual orientation. I just don't see how you can look at all those points and not come away convinced. On the other hand, I'm not saying that people are simple. Human behavior is highly overdetermined. We are so smart, and we take so long to grow up, and we are paying attention to so much stuff that, of course, lots of different things are having an influence on us, and they all go into the gamish, and, you know, the result that comes out, you know, is not easy to predict from any one factor. So I'm not trying to say that there's any factor, including genotype, that's going to let you predict perfectly whether someone will be gay or straight. But on the other hand, when you look across these populations and you look at these differences, it's clear that prenatal processes do have a say in whether you'll be attracted to men or women. And so, I mean, given that those factors are there, then it's clear nature does have a say in whom you love. And so, thank you. Do I have a volunteer that'll take the microphone around to people who have questions? But I know you're not volunteering for that necessarily. We have a question, so you get to start.
I just wanted to clarify. You're saying that gay men are more likely to be left-handed than the rest of the population. Is that correct?
It's true. Both gay males are more likely to be left-handed than straight males, and lesbians are more likely to be left-handed than straight women. You can't tell someone's sexual orientation based on handedness. I think the lady right next to you has a question.
Are you going to do this series again next year?
No. Will we be doing the series again next year? No. I mean, so my goal. First of all, I want to get Mike Bailey here early next year to talk about the influence of genes, and then. My adrenal glands are getting slightly bigger all the time as I think about trying to get this documentary made next semester. So that's the next stage, is to try to put all this together in a smaller format. Because in addition to the lectures you've been hearing, we've also been videotaping interviews with these individuals where we have more direct questions and the like. Really, can someone volunteer to take the microphone over to Alex over there? Thanks, Casey.
I was wondering where, John Money, Dr. Money at Johns Hopkins in the early days of genital manipulation, how he fits into the picture. I understand that some of the early interventions were based on shallow evidence and may have screwed up some people's lives.
Well, yeah, so remember I told you about the case of John and Joan that I was
right.
Told about in introductory psychology. So that was the work of John Money, and he was a highly effective advocate. He pushed hard to that case and others.
Evangelist.
He was definitely an evangelist that social factors were enough to explain gender role and gender identity and sexual orientation, etc. And the kindest thing I can say, what he said at the time when the truth about David came out, what he said was that the family had stopped talking to him, and so he didn't know what was to,
He never changed his opinion.
Well, he never publicly changed his opinion. No, not. But at the very least, it's clear that he was wrong.
He had significant influence.
Yeah. I was listening. Right. I'm a freshman in college, and I hear the case, and wow. To me, it was almost an existence proof, right? Which is how he presented it. Here's a child that got absolutely normal prenatal testosterone and perfectly happy as a girl. Well, turned out she wasn't. Way back there, Casey.
Given the social constructs are the only way you can raise a family if you're not heterosexual, generally speaking, has anyone done any studies into why a species wants to reproduce and what maybe that has, how that maybe affects in a population, the number of people, percentage-wise, that are homosexual?
Yeah. So it's a great question. Something people have thought about and talked about a lot, especially when people talk about genes for sexual orientation and the evolution by natural selection. And so you'll hear people say, "Well, how could there be genes that favor homosexuality, since that would reduce your fitness, right? That would reduce the chance you'd reproduce." Well, I think for anyone that has much sophistication in biology, that argument really doesn't hold any water whatsoever. So for example, I mean, so there's several reasons why such things could be maintained. Number one, let me point out to you that among the heterosexuals, about 10% of them are infertile. Well, I mean, does that prove that natural selection doesn't work? No. That just proves that you know, not everyone. Darwin never said natural selection means that everyone will be perfect. What he said was, in every population, there's a lot of variability in how much and how likely individuals are to reproduce, and natural selection uses that variability to have species evolve over time. And so, in the interview for 60 Minutes, I actually said this, and my daughter thought it was really good that they didn't use it. How can there be a gene for homosexuality? How can it be maintained in the population? Well, speaking as a short, flat-footed, incredibly myopic person, right, who nevertheless, you know, I managed to reproduce, right? Who says that there aren't, you know, suboptimal genes out there? And plenty of them. I've got a bunch, right? And in fact, everybody does, right? So, and then the sexual antagonism theory, it seems pretty clear. If there's a gene that, when it occurs in a male, reduces the chance they'll have children, but if it occurs in a female, increases the chance that she'll have children, then that sort of gene would be maintained. And there's evidence of that. Gay men, on average, their female relatives have more children than the female relatives of straight males.
I just want to thank you when I have people say, oh, I'm going to pray away the gay, or it's a choice. Thank you. Now I have some things that have scientific proof. Thank you.
Sure. Any? Okay. Thanks for coming. And again, we'll post on whomyoulove.com once we get Dr. Bailey's lecture scheduled. It'll be hopefully sometime early next year.